What a brilliant, brilliant, beautiful moment just to be here right now in front of you guys. There's nothing scarier than this moment right here to me. I am an introvert to the core, no matter how much all my friends and family say that about me. Communication is difficult for me. Intimate, personal conversation is difficult for me. So just keep that in mind when you hear this, because I have no idea what I'm doing in all of these speeches. I literally have no idea. So I'm obsessed with challenge, and I love challenge, and I think that's a very vital part about being alive. It's just doing things that make us scared, that make us nervous, things that just make us feel. We live with so much comfort in our daily life, and right now my heart is pounding, and I love every second of this because this is just the feeling of life. So a quick backstory to me, I went to college, graduated about 10 years ago, was going the normal route, business. Didn't really know what to do with that. I was going to move out to LA and didn't know what really. And I had a tremendous teacher, a sociology teacher, that played a massive impact on me and my life. And she steered me in the direction of connection and the power of understanding people. And sociology is obviously why people do what they do. Psychology is why people think like they think. And I was obsessed with this idea of just trying to understand why people do what they do. And I saw it as a superpower. If you could better understand that. And so as I was graduating college, still a little bit lost in direction, I went through just a tremendous heartbreak. A girl that I had no doubt that I was going to marry. We had been together for a long time, and we were going to graduate college, move back to St. Louis, be married, have the life, have a home, have all these things. And then one day, it was all taken from me, and I didn't know what to do. And I'm a very emotional, very empathetic person, to a fault quite a bit, but I love it. And so I didn't know what to do. And so what I did was I just started to travel, and I just started to move, and I started to run. And at the time, it felt beautiful because I was free, and I had no ties to any emotional relationships. I was completely free. No one could hurt me again. And my dad, who's I credit for so much of who I am today, would always ask me, are you running from something or are you running to something? And I always said, oh, I'm running to something. I'm just traveling the world, living life. And it was great for a period of time. And as I did that, I fell in love with photography. I wanted to capture pictures to help show the stories of the places that I was in. And as I got better through time, I found some success with travel and landscape photography. And made that my life for quite a while. Left LA, moved down to Mexico, living on a beach, had everything in the world of just a carefree, beautiful life. But I was missing challenge. I was missing that feeling of being alive. And so I did a project where I went, and these two projects are kind of tied in together, but I went 22,000 miles and I asked everybody on that trip for a piece of wisdom. And I was in Mexico, didn't know what to do next, and I met this one gentleman at a little restaurant in this place called San Quintin in the Baja, and he was 76 years old. His name was Alan, and I said, Alan, would you tell me a piece of wisdom? And he said, Adam, I've been traveling the world for over 50 years with me and my wife, and almost nonstop. And he said, you're starting to live a life similar to me, and I want to give you a great piece of wisdom. As you start to go out and experience the same things that I've experienced, you're going to see beautiful mountains, beautiful rivers, beautiful oceans, beautiful cities and people. And he said, but when you get to the end of your life, and he's towards the end of his life now, he said, the only thing you're going to remember is the people that you met along the way. That was all I needed to hear. I knew what my next challenge was. I knew that I'm an introvert. I knew I couldn't be more scared of being close to people again. And so I reached out to a company, and I said, would you sponsor me to travel all the United States, Canada, and Mexico and find the best place to live? Because I have no idea where I want to go or what to do. And they said no. And I said, great. And lots of places said no. And for some reason, I just was like, this is actually like a really good fit. And so I emailed them back, and I just, all these lists, and I just said, I think this is actually advantageous for both sides. And they came back, and they said, yeah, all right, we'll do it. I said, okay, great. And after 22,000 miles, I picked Coeur d'Alene as my pick. Coeur d'Alene for a massive sense of beauty, of local feeling, of not too small, not too big, lots of beauty around it. But I really picked Coeur d'Alene for the people, for the community, because here was a place where I didn't know a single person, and the moment I stepped foot there, I felt welcomed. I felt like people wanted to get to know me, and I wanted to get to know them. So I moved there. This girl, we spent 10 months on the road together every single day. We were together for over 3 years. I was going to marry her. There's no way I was not going to marry her. And as life will do sometimes, we got pulled apart. And here we are in a city where we don't even know anyone else, and our relationship broke and failed. Here I was in a place where I knew nothing, no one at any point, and I was deeply depressed, and I was at the wall. And I'm so grateful that I come from a strong family where suicide was never an option, but if I didn't come from a strong family, suicide probably would have been the option. My only other option was complete madness, was to just do something insane, which is something else I love to do. And so I'm at my friend Teva's house, and I'm sitting there in the house by myself, and I look on a computer, look at a map, and I just say, I'm going to just get on a plane, and I'm going to just go to Europe. I love the idea of train travel. I love the idea of meeting people on trains. We're all stuck in this place together. And I'm just going to go there. I'm going to go to every country I can, and I'm just going to walk up to people and ask for their photograph. I contacted Eurail, and they sent me an email back with a bunch of questions, and I answer the questions. I say, yeah, we'll sponsor you. I was like, no way. Okay, great. So they send me this pass, this unlimited pass. And I just said, I was at a period of madness here, and I just said, I need full creative control. I got to do this my way. And so here we are. Just let me do this my way. They said, you got it. I said, oh, my God, okay. I was the first photographer they've ever partnered with in their history. And so they gave me a forever pass. And a forever pass allows me to jump on any train, any point in time, and ride trains through every country in Europe and never have to have a reservation or anything. And it was incredible. And so my idea was just to meet people on the trains, but look out the windows, see something beautiful, jump on the train. Train leaves. I have no idea where I am. Another train comes along. Hop on that. Keep going. And I was kind of back in this cycle of movement. And I'm very free and very comfortable in that cycle. I remember the first night, flew to Denmark, get there, I am sick to my stomach. I am absolutely sick to my stomach, can't sleep, so scared, so, again, all alone in a new place, now in a different country. And I just knew I had to start. And walk out on my Airbnb, beautiful cobblestone streets, see this suave guy with a scarf, smoking a cigarette, leaning against the wall, gorgeous picture. And I walk up calmly, sir, I give him my little speech, and he says, no. And I was like, all right, we'll start with rejection. Here we go. So let's just have some fun. And I just kept going, though, and I would just, okay, and I did it, and someone said yes, and I did it, and someone said no, and yes, and no, and I just tried to take the personal aspect out of it because it really wasn't about me. But what I was really doing was walking up to people and giving them a speech. They would say yes. This guy actually said no, but I said please, and he said yes, okay. And then I was like, you don't understand how good this picture is. You have to let me take this picture. And so he said yes. And then I would step away. And I was just watching these moments. I was never influencing these moments. These were just moments all around me. And things of just emotion that I saw. But I was still protected. I was still behind a little wall. And still very carefully behind my camera. And it wasn't until this moment right here when everything changed. I was in Milan, jumped off the train, didn't know what to do, walking around the train station, and I see this gentleman sitting on the stoop here. Now, outside of the train station, there was hundreds, if not thousands, of refugees everywhere. Didn't know where to go, what to do, didn't have jobs, and they were kind of in transition, you know, and we have a very difficult refugee crisis right now. And I saw this gentleman sitting all by himself, one of the only ones, and I walked up to him, and this is the picture I saw in my brain. And so I said, oh my gosh, I photographing people all over the world. Would you mind if I please take this beautiful photograph? And he said, no. And I just said, and I was exhausted at this point. And I was just like, it's so wonderful though. This is such a great speech. But I didn't say anything. No words came out. I just awkwardly stared at him for probably 5 seconds of eternity. And he stared back at me like I have no idea why he was still looking at me. And in that little moment, he said, well, what are you going to do with it? And I was like, oh, yeah, yeah, let me show you. And I just like pull out my phone and show him on the website. Oh, yeah, and the other people. And he's really thinking hard. And he finally looks at me and he says, okay, you can take my photograph, very deliberately. And I run over and I go to this spot where I saw the picture. I take the exact picture. Again, don't tell him what to do. He looks at me, gives me this great smile. And I bring him back the camera and I show him the picture on the back of the camera. And he slowly takes the camera from me, and he looks closer at the picture. And in that picture, I'm just standing there, complete silence. And he looks at it, and he looks up at me, and he looks back at the camera, and he looks back at me, and he says, no one's ever asked to take my photograph before. And it was just power in that moment of, yes, in a refugee crisis where people are getting lost all the time, but also so much more power in the sense that, yes, I saw him. And lots of people see him, but not many people interact with strangers. And so we see them, but we walk away. And so we end up always feeling alone, like no one sees us, but we all see each other. And I just knew right then, that's the power of the moment. That's what we have to be doing. And so I just got really close to people then. I would take the picture. The picture would serve as a two-second icebreaker. They would love the picture or not. They wouldn't say anything. I would then create a conversation from that. What's your story? Like, how? Tell me about, oh my gosh, you work here? What is that like? And we would just form this little organic conversation. Remember, I have no idea what I'm doing. I have no conversation in my mind planned. I just show them a picture and we go from there. And they feel that intense vulnerability and that I'm genuine and what I mean here, and I just want to get to know them. And I was just testing it in the craziest situations. I rode the trains of the German military. I got a cabin with them. We drank beer at 11 in the morning. And I was like, these guys won't connect with me. By the end of this guy's name is George, we were all crying in our cabin. He was talking about politics, about hate crimes. It was so impassionate, and it was beautiful. And I'm not doing anything except asking questions and listening and genuinely being interested. Great moment in Warsaw, Poland. Asked this gentleman for his picture. He said, of course you can take my picture, but only if I can walk you around my town and show you why I love it so much. Of course. Of course. I would love every moment of that. We had food after that. We had a deep conversation about life, and it was just incredible. And I'm doing nothing, nothing at all, but saying hello. So I'll just walk you through the power of one connection. I wish I had more time, but I don't. This is a gentleman named Rick, and I have a lovely family out here that means so much to me. And I was up at their property, and I meet this gentleman named Rick. And all I do, I'll just start from scratch, walk up. I say, my name's Adam. What's your name? And he says, my name's Rick. Oh, Rick, oh my gosh. I photograph people all over the world, but only when I see something beautiful. And this is so beautiful. Would you mind if I took this picture? He said, of course. And so I take the picture, I show it to him, and he says, great, yeah. And I said, Rick, tell me about you. What do you do? And he said, oh, I'm a stand-up comedian, 35 years. Oh, my God, what? That's incredibly difficult. 35 years. He said, yeah. I said, how'd you get into that? He said, well, I was a combat veteran in Vietnam. And the only way that I knew how to survive that was to find humor in it because it was PTSD. What? Vietnam, oh, my God, what was it? Can I ask? Well, first of all, thank you for your service, Rick. Don't thank me. I was drafted. I didn't have a choice. So I say, what was that like? And I say, Rick, if you don't mind, can I ask you a personal question? What was it like the first night you got there? He said, Adam, I remember it like it was yesterday. He said, I'm in a trench. There's two soldiers behind me trying to sleep. There's claymores in front of me. There's barbed wire fence in front of me. There's shots going all around us. We are kids. We are terrified. We have nothing. We don't even know what we're doing there. And I was terrified. And in that one moment, I drifted off to sleep out of pure exhaustion. And in that moment of sleep, I saw this beautiful country winding road with pine trees all around it, out in the wild, total paradise. And at the end of that road, I saw a beautiful home, a country home where I would live. And he said, I woke back up. I was still in hell. It never happened. And then he drifted into silence. And he said, Adam, can you come with me for a second? And we hopped in his truck, and he drove me half a mile down the road to a winding country road with a beautiful country home at the end of it where he's lived for the last 30 years of his life. And when I left that moment, I'm in tears. He hugs me, and he thanks me for just listening. And I'm moved. I'm changed because of that moment. So there's a million stories like this. I've been fortunate to have so many connections. And everyone says, how? And I don't do anything except ask. So here we are in a generation where people are now dying from feeling alone when we are not alone, from feeling alone because all they're saying is, I want to talk to this person, but I can't. I this. We're only thinking about ourselves. We're not thinking of the other person. And people are dying. Suicide rates are the highest they've ever been because people feel alone, and it's not okay anymore. We must connect. We must give our life to connecting people together. So I only got 20 seconds. I see the most beautiful thing right in front of me. I really want to get a picture of this guy. Seconds. Here we go. 1, 2, 3. Perfect. Thank you guys so much. Love you guys.